Welcome, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. I'm Halise Lieberman, and I am the director of the Taube Center based here in Warsaw. And I'm thrilled to welcome more than 660 people who've registered. We hope you'll all join us from really around the world. And excuse me, but I have to read the list not to miss any country or community that's represented. Austria, Australia, Belarus, Brazil, Canada, El Salvador, Germany, Ireland, Israel, Italy, Latvia, and Lithuania, Poland, Russia, Serbia, Sweden, the UK, and the United States. We are delighted to have you all with us as we welcome our honored guests, Professor Sam Kassow, Dariusz Stola, and our moderator, Shana Penn. The Taube Center, as many of you heard in the previous talks, is dedicated to bringing conversations about Polish Jewry, history, culture, politics, and the arts to our shared global table. And when our world began to shelter at home, we sadly had to put our Taube Jewish Heritage Tour program on the shelf, but not for long. So for now, instead of inviting you to Poland, which we hope we will be able to do in the not too distant future, TJHT Talks will bring historical themes and contemporary issues to you. I want to take a moment to make sure that you're comfortable, that you are ready for what will be a compelling conversation, and to warmly greet some of our colleagues from partner organizations who've joined with us. Among them, the Polish Embassy in Washington, D.C., U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, the Pauline Museum here in Warsaw, the JFCS Center in San Francisco, Hebrew Union College, March of the Living UK, the International Association of Jewish Genealogy Societies, Centropa, Yad Vashem, the Pardes Institute, the Emanuel Ringelblum Jewish Historical Institute, the Olma Family Museum of Poles Saving Jews in Markova, and of course, all of our past and future TJHT tour participants. One word about logistics. Everyone will be on mute. Our Q&A session will begin about 45 minutes into the program. If you haven't submitted a question, please feel free to do so. If you would like to share a comment on what brought you to this particular session, we would be delighted to learn. And all you need to do is load it through the Q&A button, which you can find at the bottom of your Zoom screen. Unfortunately, we will not be able to answer all of your questions, but please know we will share all of your comments and questions with Sam, with Dariusz, and with Shana. And now, I am honored to invite Shana Penn, the Executive Director of the Taube Philanthropies, to introduce our guests. Taube Philanthropies has supported various Ringelblum Archive projects determined to bring this consequential history to public light, including the publication of the archives in Polish and in English by the Ringelblum Archives Institute, the exhibitions at the Emanuel Ringelblum Jewish Historical Institute and at Pauline Museum, and the docudrama film by Roberta Grossman based on Sam's book and bearing the same name, Who Will Write Our History? Special greetings to Roberta Grossman, thank you for joining us today. So Shana, without further ado.
Thank you, Elise, and greetings to everyone. It's really exciting to see all of your welcome remarks to us on the chat. Thank you so much. Sam Kassow and Dariusz Stola are eminent historians whose special areas of research include 20th century European history and the Holocaust. Dariusz Stola, as the Pauline Museum's director from the year of its grand opening in 2014 through February 2019, and Sam Kassow as one of the scholars who co-created the Pauline Museum's core exhibition, have each also gained experience and appreciation for transmitting scholarship into accessible educational storytelling formats through Pauline's social history narrative exhibition intended for broad and diverse audiences. Certainly the story of the Ringelblum Archive is one such epic social history that is finally reaching global audiences, due first and foremost to Sam Kassow's phenomenal act of historical rescue of this, for a long time, little known story, which Sam painstakingly researched and reconstructed over decades, dating back to when he was my college advisor, dating back to when Dariusz was probably in grade school, no doubt already reading Marx and Weber. How fortunate I was to study with a professor like Sam, who could connect his students to the humanity of interwar East European Jewish life, a world that perished in the Holocaust, and yet, through the Jewish voices preserved in the Ringelblum Archive, we can remember these individuals and their world, and in so doing, remember what really matters. When it comes to what really matters today, it is a rare person who can responsibly speak truth to power, as can Dariusz Stola, a visionary leader of Poline during his tenure. Earlier this month, Taube Philanthropies selected Dariusz Stola as the 2020 recipient of our annual Irena Sendler Award. Sendler was one of the first Yad Vashem recognized righteous Gentiles for her mission to rescue Jewish children from the Warsaw Ghetto. Due to the pandemic, we cannot yet schedule a public ceremony to honor Dariusz. For now, we invite you to join us in sending him mazel tovs via chat. Mazel tov, Dariusz.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah. When Sam Kassow's monumental book, Who Will Write Our History? Emmanuel Ringelblum, the Warsaw Ghetto, and the Oyneg Shabbat Archive, was first published in 2008, the New Republic wrote, "This may well be the most important book about history that anyone will ever read. It is also a very important book of history. And as a tale about why doing history matters, Sam Kassow's book has few equals in our collective record." Welcome, Sam Kassow, Dariusz Stola.
Thank you very much, Shaina. It's been a great honor for me to receive the Irena Sendler Award. I'm truly moved. It's been recently. I would like to use this opportunity to thank my colleagues at the Poline Museum, because everything that I have done, I've done in a team of great people and working on a solid basis prepared by eminent scholars, including Sam Kassow, who is one of the co-creators, one of the authors of the core exhibition at the Poline Museum. But the topic of our today meeting is a story which is truly fascinating, the story of the Warsaw Ghetto Archive prepared by a few dozen people. And without further ado, let us start, because we have some unique visual material. We have a film showing the discovery, the unearthing of the first part of the Warsaw Ghetto Archive at Nowolipski 68th Street in the middle of the Warsaw Ghetto. You see this a sea of rubble, and beneath a basement, the first part of the Ringelblum Archive was discovered in 1946. So it was truly a miracle. You can see a fragment of it, mostly written in Yiddish or in Polish. Exceptional material, and we have the best person in the world to talk about it. That is Sam Kassow. Sam, could you please tell us first, who are these people? Who did gather this material, put them into hiding, and then discover?
Well, the person who organized the archive was Emmanuel Ringelblum, who was a Polish-Jewish historian and a community activist. He was born in 1900, so he was only 39 years old when the war began. He really believed that history mattered, and that history was a vital factor preserving the Jewish people. Before the war, he was active in the YIVO. During the war, he organizes the Oneg Shabbat archive to document Jewish life under the Nazi occupation. And he gathers a large number of collaborators, about 60 people all together. About a week before he was captured by the Germans, in one of his last letters, he wrote to a close friend of his, "What will happen if none of us survives? What will happen to the archive?" And Ringelblum had good reason to worry because of the 60 or so people that he brought together in that collective mission of national memory, men and women, the famous, the not so famous. Of those 60 people, there are only 3 survivors by the end of the war. And only one, Hirsch Wasser, knew where the archive had been buried. The other 2 survivors was Blume Wasser, Wasser's wife, and Rachel Auerbach, who would go on to play a major role in keeping the flame, in protecting the memory of Emanuel Ringelblum. Wasser survived by a very thin margin, once jumping from a train, taking him to Treblinka, another time surviving in a bunker during the Warsaw Uprising in 1944, where a grenade almost killed him and his wife. When the war was over, those 3 survivors, Wasser, Blume, and Auerbach, they cajoled, they begged people to start looking for the archive buried under the ruins of the Jewish school on Novolipki 68. But as you've seen from the pictures, it wasn't easy. Warsaw was just rubble. It seemed like an impossible task. But finally, an expedition was organized with surveyors and engineers. And in September 1946, after a lot of digging, after a lot of guessing, a shovel hit one of the first of what turned out to be 10 tin boxes. That was the first cache of the archive, which was buried in August 1942, shortly after the beginning of the Great Deportation to Treblinka. Wasser said, "Keep digging. We found a lot more. We buried a lot more things. This is just a little bit." But they dug and dug. They couldn't find anything else. And then Wasser and his wife and Auerbach went to Israel as Poland became more communist. And 4 years later, in December 1950, when Polish construction workers were building new apartment buildings on the ruins of the former ghetto, they came across 2 aluminum milk cans. This was the second cache of the archive, which had been buried in late February 1943. The milk cans protected the documents much better than the tin cans of the first cache, where a lot of water seepage had caused quite a bit of damage. Wasser said to his dying day that there was a third cache buried shortly before the outbreak of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising in April 1943. This was buried on the site of the brushmaker shop near Świętojarska 34. Over time, that became the site of the Chinese embassy in Poland. Some years ago, Israelis got permission from the Chinese to search the site. That third cache was never found. My sense is that scavengers after the war probably found documents and scattered them. But some people still hope that the third cache is still there and might yet be retrieved.
Actually, I am among those few people who still hope. Every time I pass by the Chinese embassy at Świętojarska Street, they have a huge garden. I still have a hope that a few meters beneath the ground, the boxes or the cans with the rest of the archive remain. But if we can see again this panorama of the rubble of the Warsaw Ghetto, you can realize how lucky we are that Hirsch Wasser survived the war and could locate it. It was a sea of rubble. You can see a tall tower of a church. This is the St. Augustine Church, which Germans preserved. You will see it on your left in a second. this is the central part of the ghetto. By the way, here is the Chinese embassy now, in front of the place in front of you. In a second, you will see the classical building remaining. These were the 18th century military barracks. This is where the Pauline Museum stands at present. Mm. And now you can see fragments of the Krasiński Park and the tall tower. This is the St. Augustine Church. And some 200 meters beneath the church, behind the church, was Novolipki 68, the ruins of Novolipki 68 of the Borochov School, where the first part of the archive was located, hidden in, I think it was August 1942. But when Ringelblum and his friends started collecting the documentation, they didn't know yet what was the horrible future of the Warsaw Ghetto. They didn't know that they were documenting the annihilation of the Warsaw Ghetto.
No. The archive began in 1940. German didn't decide until sometime late in 1941 to kill all the Jews. So of course, when the archive began, they believed that somehow after the war, Polish Jewry would survive. And their agenda was to document Polish Jewish life, to collect artifacts, and then to use the knowledge gained by studying Jewish life during the occupation, use that knowledge to help the Jewish people in Poland revive when the war was over. This was very much in the tradition of the YIVO, the Yiddish Scientific Institute, of which Ringelblum was a leading member. The archive was a direct continuation of that YIVO ethos of using knowledge of a living Jewish people gained in the present through interviews, through active study, through interdisciplinary study, use that knowledge to help the Jews better know themselves and to become more resilient and more able, better able to face the challenges thrown at them by anti-Semites, by various forms of discrimination, to develop, to become a self-affirming, self-confident people. That was the agenda of the archive until 1942. The pièce de résistance was a projected 1,600-page study of Polish Jewry under the occupation. 80 topics: women, corruption, children, religious life, Polish-Jewish relations, German-Jewish relations. Each topic had a team leader. Some members of the Oyneg Shabbos were team leaders of four or five different sections. And this work was in full swing when in July 1942, the deportations to Treblinka began, and Ringelblum then sent his two key secretaries to contact all of the workers in the archive and tell them to hand over everything, hand over their unfinished notes, hand over their unfinished essays, hand it over, and this was what was buried in the first cache on August 3rd, 1942.
The methodology that they were using at that time was quite innovative for the period. The idea that you can gather documents like tickets or interview ordinary people in the various functions was quite innovative. Where did it come from? Did it invent it or take it for someone else?
Well, Ringelblum was a Marxist. He was very interested in new approaches to history that stressed what today would be called Alltagsgeschichte, the history of everyday life. He was interested in the history of cuisine, climate. He wanted Jewish history to focus not so much on the elites, on the wealthy, on ideas, as to focus on the ordinary people, how they lived their lives. He was interested in the Annales school of French historians. He was interested in some of the oral history that was being done in Leningrad. And he took all this And in the YIVO in the 1930s, he advocated for this kind of expanded historical approach. He helped found a seminar of young historians. So this wider approach to a history with its emphasis on ordinary people, on material history, on artifacts, on food, all this was well developed before the war even started.
Mm-hmm. You said that Ringelblum himself was a Marxist. He was a left-wing. He was a left-wing Zionist. What were his relations with people of other orientations, like Agudat Israel or revisionist Zionists or mainstream Zionists at that time?
Well, it's an interesting question, because by our standards, Ringelblum would be seen as someone who was extremely PC, someone who was extremely politically correct. And his party, the Left Labor Zionists, was a party that was very combative and that fought everybody, from the communists to the Bundists to religious Jews. So in theory, Ringelblum was politically very active in a particular ideology. But in reality, right from the beginning, Ringelblum was able to distinguish between his politics and the need to involve all kinds of Jews in a common national mission. Ringelblum did not check his politics at the door. He was very much motivated by his political beliefs, but he reached out to everybody. And in that sense, he was extremely tolerant. The people in the Oyneg Shabbos included rabbis like Shimon Huberbond, Zionists, Bundists, communists. And so it was because of Ringelblum's willingness to work with all kinds of people that this project became so successful.
A part of his progressive perspective was the substantial role of female members of the Oneg Shabbat and the focus on the life of women in the Warsaw Ghetto. Could you please tell something about the women in the team?
Yeah, as I said, he believed that Jewish historians have to bring in the forgotten actors of Jewish history, women, apprentices, artisans, actors, beggars. Women, unfortunately, had been marginalized in Jewish studies. So as part of this study project of Jewish society under the occupation, which was begun in 1941, Ringelblum blocked out a separate distinct project, Jewish Women. And he appointed Cecilia Slapakova to study different kinds of Jewish women and to come up with a interpretive synthetic essay on the Jewish woman during the war. This was found in the first cache of the archive. The archive included other women. There was Gela Sextine, who was an artist, and she's holding her daughter Margalit. She was married to Israel Lichtenstein, who preserved the actual documents in a secret hiding place as they were coming in. There was Rachel Auerbach, who was a very important collaborator. There were other women like the poetess Laza Vertova. Genya Silkis. There were women who were asked to study the role of child caregivers, of nurses in the hospitals. So they played a very, very important role in the archive.
Speaking of Gela Sextein, let me make a personal comment. When we were opening the core exhibition of the Pauline Museum 5 years ago, and I was to greet the distinguished guests present, including President of Poland, President of Israel, and many really important people, I couldn't find better words than a quotation from a piece of paper, a testament, a message, which she left in the ghetto together with her drawings. And she wrote that she would like these objects to be put on display in a future Jewish museum in Warsaw. So this is what we were doing 5 years, 5 years ago. But she perished, her family perished. And as you said, almost all of the members of the archive were killed during the war. Only three of them survived. What they were doing after the war?
After the war, for the first few years after the war, Wasser and Auerbach were in Poland. They played a major role in the publication of the first examples of post-Holocaust scholarship. Poland, in fact, between 1944 and 1947, 1948, became one of the key centers of Holocaust scholarship in the world. And quite a lot was published in Yiddish and in Polish. Auerbach published a book on the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. She published a book on the Treblinka, which she visited with some of the survivors. Hirsch Wasser was active in the early days of the Jewish Historical Institute. But then as Poland became more Stalinist, most of the Jewish historians who were so creative in those early days left Poland. Philip Friedman, Karamish, Trunk. Wasser, his wife, and Rachel Auerbach went to Israel, where, as I said before, Auerbach became very active in the development of Yad Vashem. One of the things that Auerbach really did that was so important was to lay the groundwork for organized collection of survivor testimony, and then to ensure that that survivor testimony was not marginalized, but given priority. There were some key historians like Raoul Hilberg, who said that survivor testimony is unreliable, that we have to prefer documents, which by the nature of things were more likely to be left by the Germans than by survivors. But it was people like Auerbach who said, no, we have to listen to the voice of the witness. We have to listen to the voice of the survivor. And she had a real role in persuading Gideon Hausner to base the Eichmann trial on survivor testimony rather than primarily on documents, as was the case with the Nuremberg trials. And she always saw herself as the keeper of the flame. She always had a picture of Ringel Blum on her desk. She felt that she had survived to ensure that Ringel Blum and his achievements would not be forgotten.
One of the important topics of Ringelblum's personal research were the Polish-Jewish relations, actually his last manuscript that he wrote when hiding in a bunker in Grujecka Street, so-called Krysia, yeah, where he remained up to 1944, was exactly on the Polish-Jewish relations. What did he think about it?
This is an extraordinary book that he wrote, and it really is a book. He wrote this in a bunker with 30 odd people living in fear, with no air, with quarrels all around him. And there he sat in a corner writing by the dim light of a carbide lamp. And he literally wrote thousands of pages. And once a week, a courier, Wander Rothenberg, would come to the hideout, take what he wrote, give him more ink and more paper. When he began that book on Polish-Jewish relations, you could feel the incredible emotional pressure that he was under. He felt that he was the last Jewish historian left in Poland, that 8 centuries of a shared life on the Polish lands were now ending in bitterness and anger and recrimination. And Ringelblum felt that he had to get it right, that he had to push back against these simplifications and the stereotypes coming from both sides, that even though he was writing not just as a scholar, but as a victim who indeed would very soon lose his own life, he struggled to rise above this and to, as far as possible, approach the issue as an objective historian. And so in the introduction to this book, Ringelblum, the Marxist, begins by comparing himself to a cipher, someone who writes a Torah scroll. He says, I feel like I'm about to write a sefer Torah, a Torah scroll, and the scribe cannot make any mistakes. And I feel that I can't make any mistakes. And then he carefully laid out all the complexities of Polish-Jewish relations, emphasizing that until a certain point, until 1942, the Jewish perception of Poles was not unquestionably negative, that there were many positive testimonies as well. And the turn for the worse only took place when the mass murder begins in 1942. That's when Polish-Jewish relations really begin to deteriorate. And Ringelblum, even as he condemns and criticizes the actions of the Polish Home Army and the Polish underground government, Ringelblum recognizes the difficulties that Poles faced in hiding Jews. He recognizes the bravery of the Polish people in resisting the German occupier. But one point that he underscores is that whereas it was socially acceptable and even encouraged among the Polish population to resist the Germans, to help Jews and hide Jews was less socially acceptable. In fact, it was socially unacceptable. And Poles trying to help Jews feared their Polish neighbors almost as least as much as they feared the Germans. And so Ringelblum cited an example in his book, which I think says quite a lot. He said that he had just heard that the Germans were pursuing a fleeing Polish fighter through the streets of Warsaw, and all the Germans had to yell was catch the Jew, and somebody helped the Germans catch this fleeing Polish fighter. And Ringelblum said this was the problem, that while there were many brave, selfless Poles, large sections of the Polish people had been infected with the kind of anti-Semitism, which meant that even if they personally did not harm Jews, they looked askance at active efforts to rescue Jews. So Ringelblum's basic conclusion was rather negative, but it was a heroic effort. It was the first effort to try to understand this hideously complex issue from a scholarly point of view.
Well, his life, his fatal end, actually a few days later, after he completed this report, confirms this complexity, because the bunker was very well hidden under a greenhouse. And that was because of a denunciation that the German police arrived and they killed not only the 40 Jews in hiding, but also the Polish family that was hiding them nearby. But you mentioned the term resistance. We usually think about resistance during the war as armed resistance, you know, fighters in the Warsaw Ghetto uprising or the Polish members of the Home Army. Was the activity of the archive team a form of resistance?
Absolutely.
They were risking their life.
Not only was it a form of resistance, but it turned out to be a successful example of resistance. One of Ringelblum's teachers, the historian Isaac Shipper, said in Majdanek, just before he was killed, what we know about murdered peoples is usually what their killers choose to tell us about them. And this would have been the case with the Jews. The Germans not only intended to murder all the Jews, but then decide on what terms they would be remembered. And the Jews in the ghetto saw the German propaganda posters. They saw the Germans comparing Jews to vermin. they knew that not only at a given point that the Germans would murder them, but that they would then try to control their memory. And so not just in the Warsaw Ghetto, but in other ghettos, Jews buried time capsules full of documents, saying, even if we don't live to see it, the day will come when in a better world, people will find these time capsules and they'll remember us on the basis of our documents and not on the basis of German documents. And what this meant was that because of the Ringelblum archive and because of other archives like that, the Jews are not just faceless, anonymous victims. Even though they were killed, they still left documents which enable us to remember them as individuals, as part of a community, people with names, people with hopes, aspirations, with ideals. Think about this. Had the Ringelblum archive never been found, we could not have written about the internal life of the Warsaw Ghetto. We could not have written about the religious thought of the Warsaw Ghetto. We would not have had the Jewish underground press. And so this is kind of a sine qua non for any serious study of the Jews during the Holocaust as people and as members of a nation, and not just as victims huddling in a holding pen waiting to be sent to the death camps. By the way, that image that you just saw was part of the last will and testaments written by Israel Lichtenstein, Nochum Shivach, and David Graeber, members of the archive who were entrusted with burying the documents in August 1942. They knew they would be killed at any moment. 100,000 Jews had already been deported. They were hurriedly shoving the documents into tin boxes, and they were scribbling their last wills and testaments. And all those last wills and testaments miraculously survived. And that was the image that you just saw before.
These are very moving documents, and I still remember a short message from Nachum Grzywacz, whom you just mentioned. He was just 18. He was a student at the Borochow School, and I remember the sentence when he writes, "Please remember me. My name is Nachum Grzywacz." So may I call now to all the audience, please remember him. His name is Nachum Grzywacz. Today, Ringelblum is the primary hero and the guide to the Holocaust Gallery at the Pauline Museum, the Museum of the History of Polish Jews in Warsaw. And the Jewish Historical Institute, which is the custodian of the Ringelblum archive, is the Immanuel Ringelblum Jewish Historical Institute. Relics of the archives that he created with his friends are in the Yad Vashem, in the Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington, D.C. Is he known globally, or is he a forgotten hero out of Poland?
I would say he's a forgotten hero. By the way, there's also an important part of the archive at the YIVO, smuggled out by Hirsch Wasser after the war. People paid lip service to Ringelblum. They knew about the milk can. John Hersey wrote a novel loosely based on Ringelblum, but there was not a lot of serious engagement with Ringelblum or the archive. There was a wonderful scholar in Warsaw named Ruta Sakowska, who laid the groundwork for Ringelblum scholarship. She labored largely in isolation at the Jewish Historical Institute. There were scholars in Israel who wrote about Ringelblum here and there, but the archive itself was largely obscured for decades and decades. And it's only in the last few years that there's been serious attention being paid now, not just to Ringelblum, but to the implications of the archive, what the archive meant, what the archive means for understanding Jewish society during the Nazi occupation, what the archive means for our whole understanding of doing history, what the archive means for our understanding of history as a discipline. Now a lot of people are beginning to write about it, but for a long time that was not the case.
By the way, it's been, I think, last week that another volume of the English translations of these documents have been published. So there is a work in progress of publishing all the collection, and not only in the original language, as I said, mostly Yiddish and Polish, but also in English translations. So these are publications of the Jewish Historical Institute. You can find them. I see that we have many questions and the number is growing. So maybe now we can give floor to those who would like to ask us. Helise, how would you proceed with it?
You can turn it. I can start to ask those questions. Can you
yes,
hear me?
Please.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you so much. And thank you all the people who sent questions. And I'm going to start with Sam. One of the values of these archives, of these diaries, is that they're contemporaneous. And they tell us things that one doesn't hear later in memoirs, et cetera. Can you speak to that? And perhaps one of the examples might be, what did Ringelblum and his team, what was their opinion about the Judenrat, and how did they cooperate with the Judenrat?
Well, I believe it's clear that Ringelblum had a very negative attitude towards the Judenrat. And this was one of the things that made the Oyneg Shabbos archive different from, say, archives in Bialystok, Lodz, or Vilna. Ringelblum was contemptuous of many members of the Judenrat. I believe that he was unfair in his treatment of Adam Chernyakov, the head of the Judenrat. Here is a case where Ringelblum let his biases trump his objectivity. To understand the Warsaw Judenrat, you can't rely just on the Oyneg Shabbos. Ringelblum was determined to maintain secrecy. He didn't trust the Judenrat, and that meant that anybody with any Judenrat connections was not invited to join the archive. The exception that proved the rule was Shmuel Winter, who was very important in the Judenrat, but who'd been in the YIVO before the war and who Ringelblum trusted. Now, this issue of contemporaneous versus post-war testimony is critical. One important difference is that when you read Jewish documents written during the war, you see a lot of anger against other Jews. When you read survivors writing after the war, the Jews who were killed are the 6 million martyrs, they're the Kedoshim. The anger is largely censored out. Let me give you a quick example. One member of the archive was Shia Perle, a Yiddish writer who was murdered in Auschwitz in 43. In late August 42, he saw a Jewish policeman dragging a 5-year-old boy to his SS handler, saying, "This is my fifth head of the day." The Jewish police had to hand over so many Jews a day to the SS, thinking they would save their skin. The SS man pulled out a pistol, shot the little boy, told the Jewish policeman to scamper off and find an adult. And the Jewish policeman scampered off, and Perle was so angry, he wrote that a people that can produce such scum as the Jewish police perhaps deserves everything it's getting. Now, had Perle survived the war, he never would have said that, never would have written that, number one. Number two, this was found in the milk cans. That means Ringelblum read it. Ringelblum could have said, "My God, this doesn't make Jews look very good. I'd better tear this up." But precisely it was this kind of testimony which Ringelblum was careful to include. One, because it underscored his own objectivity, it underscored the bona fides of the archive, and it showed what people thought at the time. And by the way, this was true not just for Warsaw, but Lodz, Vilna too. Jews tended to be angry at other Jews. There were many other differences, but those are just some of the most important ones.
Well, speaking of Lodz and Vilnius, could you say a few words about the ghetto archives or archival work that was done during the existence of those ghettos or of other ghettos and how they compare with the Ringelblum archive?
Yeah, the Ringelblum archive was distinguished by the sheer ambition of its agenda, collecting artifacts, collecting writings, organized study of Jewish life, then the documentation of the killing. And all these agenda items evolved as time went on. In the Vilna ghetto and in the Lodz ghetto, you also had these agenda items, but they were not as well organized. In Vilna and in Lodz and in Bialystok, there was some contact with the Judenrat, with Gens in Vilna, with Barash in Bialystok, who was very close to Mordechai Tenenbaum. The Lodz ghetto archive was semi-official, meaning that Rumkowski knew about it. So these archives are all very valuable, and the Lodz ghetto archive is amazing, but it was not as independent, and it was not as far-reaching as the Oyneg Shabbos archive was. It also didn't have as many people working in it.
Sam, how did you go about your research in Warsaw at the Jewish Historical Institute during the communist era? What condition was the archive in? And because you were doing the research, did you also play a role in helping to conserve the documents?
Well, I would like to say that I did, but I didn't. I really began working on the project after communism had collapsed. When I was in Warsaw in 1985 and tried to get access to the Zich collections, and I was basically told no, because they're too disorganized. And rather than bang on doors or produce cigarettes and dollars, I simply walked away. I was very naive at that time. It was in a very disordered state. Doing this kind of research was very difficult. I'd say I spent 3 or 4 years going up dead ends because I couldn't figure out how to organize it. I couldn't write a biography of Ringelblum. I didn't want to write a history of the Warsaw Ghetto. How do you write about an archive where the documents are just stashed into boxes, many of which are illegible or incomplete? So what is the thread? What's the organizing principle? It took a long time to come up with that.
Understood. There are a few questions about writings like the Polish-Jewish relations text that Ringelblum wrote in the bunker. How could he have done it without having any secondary or primary sources to work with? How much accuracy is there? And is this published now in Polish, in Yiddish, Polish or English? Is it accessible?
Yeah, I mean, of course the book now has been superseded by decades of scholarship, but it's amazing that Ringelblum wrote this without grad students, without Xerox machines, without a Guggenheim. Yes, he was getting information from Adolf Berman. He was getting information from the Underground Jewish National Committee, which he was incorporating. As Auerbach, by the way, after she left the Warsaw Ghetto in 1943, was involved in what she called Archiv Hemshech, the continuation archive. Jewish survivors in occupied Warsaw were still encouraged to write about their experiences. So Ringelblum had access to this. But this is basically a solo work done in very difficult circumstances. And Northwestern University Press published an English translation in 1992, and it still stands up. It's still useful. It still could be read by scholars with a lot of profit. One of the ironies is that if you look at the scholarship now of Jan Gross and Jan Grabowski and Basha Engelking and others, the picture of Polish-Jewish relations that's emerging now is actually more negative than emerges in the Ringelblum book. In other words, Ringelblum did not have a lot of access to what was happening in the countryside. He did not have a lot of access to what was happening in 1943 and 1944 outside of Warsaw. So it's not the last word in Polish-Jewish relations, but as an example of someone who's trying to practice the historian's craft honestly, sincerely, and morally, this really stands the test of time.
Yes. So there are a number of questions about what to read or what to access, Sam's book, Roberta's film, and we'll send you the link to how to acquire it. There's Ringelblum's notes from the Warsaw Ghetto. There are the volumes from the Emanuel Ringelblum Jewish Historical Institute. Of the there are 35 volumes already published in Polish, and they are now being translated into English already. There are four of them, and we will send you information by email about all of this information. But what else might you add to this list for people? And can you saying something about that? Might you tell us if there were any? This was another question. Were there any writings from any of the Ringelblum team that had been taken out of the Warsaw Ghetto and hidden on the Aryan side during the war?
Well, first of all, let me say that there's a book edited by David Roskies now, Voices from the Warsaw Ghetto, which includes a lot of material from the Ringelblum archive. For somebody who wants to read about the Warsaw Ghetto, there's no better book than the book by Basha Engelking and Jacek Liocak, which was originally published in Polish, but which has appeared published by Yale University Press. There are individual diaries from the archive, Abraham Lewin, Ringelblum's diary, the diary of Shimon Huberbaum, all translated.
Aaron Kaplan.
A part of which was in the Oneg Shabbat archive, part of which was hidden separately from the Oneg Shabbat archive. If you're a scholar, there's a very good treatment of writing under the German occupation by Jacek Liocak, which I highly recommend, text in the Holocaust. Israel Gutmann's The Jews of Warsaw is still very, very useful. Javi Dreyfus of Tel Aviv University has written extremely valuable books on the Jews in occupied Poland and on the last days of the Warsaw Ghetto. So in terms of that particular subject, adding, of course, the writings of the Piasechner Rebbe, Kalonymous Shapiro, quite a lot has appeared on his theological thought, Nehemiah Poland and other authors. So there's quite a lot.
Let me add two websites. First, the official website of the archive, the onegshabbat.org. It is Polish and English fully. And also the Virtual Shtetl, the Poland Museum historical website, which gives a lot of information on the Warsaw Ghetto, but also on other ghettos, not only the big ones like Białystok or Łódź, but also the smaller ghettos. So there is quite a lot of material online easily accessible.
Right, and also when it's safe to travel again and we can all come to Warsaw, the Jewish Historical Institute, which houses the Ringelblum Archive, has a major permanent exhibition on Ringelblum and the Oneg Shabbos. And I highly recommend viewing it, and also the Pauline Museum for its Holocaust gallery begins the entrance segment makes use of Ringelblum's diary to tell about the Warsaw Ghetto. And speaking of the Ringelblum Archive, I want to give a shout out to someone who is in our webinar today, Dr. Eleonora Bergman, who's been associated with the Institute and working on the Ringelblum Archive for several decades.
Yeah, I also want to say that along with Ruta Sakowska, Lena Bergman has played a key role in kind of keeping the flame alive, maintaining the memory of Ringelblum, and making sure that not only was the archive published, but that it was published in accordance with the highest standards. She's been an incredibly important factor in all of this.
One last word from me. Many of you are asking how to be in contact with Sam Kassow, and we will make sure to make the connection after the program. Elise?
I don't know about the rest of you, but I don't want this session to end. I'm completely captivated. And so on behalf of all of us, the Taube Center team, all of our participants, all those who will get to see this on YouTube in not such a long time, I want to thank Sam and Dariusz and Shaina. Your passion and your way of bringing this story to each one of us, and it's amazing because we've had the privilege of being toured through the exhibition with Sam on several of our tours. The documents, the artifacts, everything sort of calls out to you, read me, look at me, hear me, tell about it. And the fact that all of you, Sam and Dariusz and Shaina, thank you for shepherding all the questions. Thank you for making that cry, that request, so absolutely clear in this kind of new world of Zooming. So we thank you. I just want to let you know that we should mark your calendars for actually the next segment in our series. It's TJH Talks 4. On Wednesday, June 17th, our guest will be Dr. Barbara Kirschenblatt-Gimblett. She is the leading expert in performance art and museology and the Ronald S. Lauder Chief Curator at Pauline Museum of the History of Polish Jews. So, from Warsaw, dziękuję bardzo. Thank you all very much. Toda raba. And a Shainam dank. Really, Sam, Dariusz, Shaina, thank you. We hope we'll see all of you next time.
Bye.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye.